last reader. John is a first-year fiction student. He is a Western Pennsylvania native, and his first paid job out of college was being an extra in a terrible movie about a boy band. After that, he went on to do all kinds of things, like teach English in Italy, work for nonprofits, play bass in a rock band, and work on grant proposals. When he finally grows up, he wants to be a full-time author. Welcome, John.
So what I have is, it's an excerpt from a short story, so there's really no beginning or end to it. It's just kind of a scene. And the story is called The Biggest Lie You Ever Told Yourself. The lobby is dull, scratched tile floors and plain walls in matching tans and light browns. The exposed ceiling is more incomplete than modern, and the company name isn't visible anywhere. The only identifier is the building's address, 750 First Street, stenciled across the front of the reception desk. After you check in, the receptionist takes your photo and waves you to the elevator. The door is open at the third floor. A smiling young woman with several manila folders in her hands introduces herself, but you immediately forget her name. She's wearing jeans and a striped green t-shirt. Looking around, everyone is dressed casually and leads you into a conference room where she pulls out a chair and hands you a pen. For the next hour, she sits across the table, asking that you review, complete, initial, and sign a non-disclosure agreement, a non-compete agreement, a conflict of interest statement, a document that says any intellectual property you create is property of the company, a statement that your employment is at will and may be terminated by either party at any time for any reason, a W-9, a stock option and retirement fund enrollment forms, a statement which the HR representative explains at length and repeatedly states is not a contract, but the job description, hire date, and annual compensation, and life insurance for which you don't have a beneficiary to name. Before you leave the room, she officially welcomes you to the company and hands you a newly minted badge. It's about the size of a credit card with your photo in the upper left corner and a brown band along the bottom. The name of the company isn't on it. You hold it and look at it as if it were an award. It has that hot plastic smell. The lanyard is stiff, never worn before. You put it on and you feel proud. Now an employee, you head up to the seventh floor to meet your manager. The elevator opens to a dark lobby where the shades are drawn on all the windows and there's a faint smell of buttered popcorn. You pass through a dark maze of monochrome cubicles, searching for the conference room where your manager is supposed to meet you. The only light comes from computer monitors illuminating faces that don't look up when you pass by, and the only sound is the plastic chorus of fingers on keyboards. Eventually, you find the room, but no one is there. You wait for several minutes, looking at a view of downtown skyscrapers through windows spotted with rain. The chairs are fancy and expensive looking, but uncomfortable and cold. The conference table has a cheap artificial wood veneer and is uneven and too big for the room. A wave of magazine sample cologne precedes your new manager's actual presence into the room. He's a little older than you, and he's wearing a purple patterned shirt left untucked from expensive jeans. His thicket of dark hair is best described as flung. He has a Palm Pilot in his left hand, tapping it with the stylus several times before acknowledging that you are there. As you stand up, he thrusts his right hand at you. "Hi, Aaron." By his inflection, you can't tell if he's introducing himself as Aaron or he thinks your name is Aaron. Before you respond, you realize that you've never met him during the interview process. "Have a seat," he gestures to the chair you were sitting in. "I'm the team lead. What's his face? The guy who hired you, he got reassigned to a new group." He reaches in his back pocket and pulls out several sheets of paper, folded lengthwise, and flattens them out on the table. After scanning the pages for a minute, he says, "Your last job was at a cafe? Well, I guess we've all got to start somewhere. Since they offered you the job, you must be all right. But since I didn't hire you, I expect you to prove yourself to me. Show me why you belong in this team and at this company." He emphatically taps his index finger on the desk. "I expect a lot, and you better deliver. The strategic transactions team meets Mondays and Wednesdays to evaluate, and Fridays they bring the results to division management. Everything's due to my inbox no later than Thursday night. Mr. Palm Pilot looks at his watch. We've got a team meeting in a few minutes. Let's go. He gets up and bolts out of the room, and you struggle to keep up, navigating through the darkness, murmuring and keyboard tapping. A few yards ahead, you see his hair stride into another meeting room. As you enter, a sallow man about your age stares blankly at nothing in particular. A young woman with straw blonde hair crosses her arms and looks out the window. Another young woman, red in the face and clenching her jaw, fussily arranges papers into separate piles. As he shuts the door, Mr. Palm Pilot announces to the room, "Everyone, this is the new employee." Then he firmly tells you to have a seat, we've got work to do, and you've got a lot to learn. After the meeting, your new coworkers silently disperse, and you wander the cubicles looking for yours. Eventually, you find it in a dark, windowless corner among a set of empty desks. The whole area smells like gym sweat and old coffee. The closest neighbor, a few seats away, a young woman wearing headphones, staring at her screen with focus and intensity. You try to catch her gaze to find some kind of acknowledgement, but there's nothing there. You sit down at your desk, which is no larger than an unabridged dictionary, and log in. The desk is sticky, as if a sugary drink had been spilled and hastily wiped up. The keyboard feels greasy and is full of crumbs and dust. From the letters, some of the letters, namely the E, R, A, and M, are almost completely worn off, and the space bar is a shiny spot from being hammered by a right-hand thumb. As you begin working, your eyes begin to strain from the bright screen. You wonder when they will turn the lights on.